Joining me to take this discussion forward are three veteran bankers, Sunil Srivastava, former Deputy Managing Director of State Bank of India, V. Srinivasan, former Deputy Managing Director of Axis Bank, R. K. Bansal, Managing Director and CEO of Edelweiss ARC, and also former ED at IDBI Bank. Hopefully in a bit we should be getting the IBA CEO, Mr. Sunil Mehta, as well. Gentlemen, thank you very much for joining me. Well, first, Mr. Bansal, is there a case for a moratorium at all, or shall we just stop that argument?
It depends. It's a sector specific. If you look at it, yes, there is a case for moratorium, but I don't think there is a case for general moratorium today.
Okay. Well, in that case, let me straight away start with restructuring. What's your sense? Should a restructuring be? Is there enough justification for one-time restructuring to be granted?
I think so. Basically, moratorium is also nothing more than a restructuring. So, frankly speaking, when you give a 6 months time, which has already been given, you have to finally put these installment or interest payments somewhere else. Mm. And for RBI definition, it becomes a restructure in that sense.
Okay.
So I feel keeping in view the 6 months or even 9 months delay and delay in recovery by the industry, there is a case for restructuring, one-time restructuring, more in a few sectors, but in general also, but with some conditions, with some, I think, safeguards, which we have to keep for restructuring. Mm.
Okay. Srini, you know, both the banker and the central banker are on the same page in a sense. If you just heard Rajnish Kumar, and we quoted that appropriate soundbite to you, he also says that it should be only a lengthening of the time, and it should be related to the cash flow of the entity. Are you in favor of any kind of reschedulement, and how can you make it so tight? How can you ensure it is not a repeat of what we saw between 2000 and 2015?
Well, one thing we should be clear, I think the bankers this time around will be a lot more conservative and a lot more tight compared to the previous cycle because of the experience over the last almost 7-8 years. I think the banker went into the last round of restructuring and know how it is gone and how it is to pick up the pieces, and still, I think they are still picking up the pieces and still not back on the rails. So I think the whole thing of trying to sort of push the can down the road, it just keeps rolling and you have to keep running after it. And that is something which needs to get avoided, and that's why I think whether RBI is lenient or not, the bankers are going to be a lot more strict this time around than before. That said, I think I would agree with Mr. Bansal that a one-time restructuring because of the pandemic is something which is needed, but with adequate safeguards. The way I would look at it is that you need to provide some relief because of the exceptional conditions, and two, you should not be providing any relief to zombie companies or companies which are hardly up, considering that the lockdown is broadly lifted and people are up anywhere between 50% to 90% of the pre-COVID levels.
Okay.
The way to look at it is to try and bucket industries into two buckets, severely impacted and moderately impacted, and try and provide relief saying that, okay, if you are operating at 70% of your pre-COVID levels, the repayment obligations up to 70% or whatever it is, 50%, would be sort of payable on the due dates, and the remaining will turn it off for a period of time, which is anywhere between 3 and 5 years, by which time hopefully things will be normal. Mm. So you need to do a slight nuancing of the whole thing in terms of bucket sectors and try and provide relief based on what you believe is going to be the business level. Don't try and, I mean, that could be the maximum provided. Yeah. Bankers provide less. But the whole thing should be that.
But, 1 minute. You know, Srini, if you say that if you are operating at 70%, then you are forced, you shall pay 70% of the loans, and you get to extend maybe 30% of your loans. If you're trying to do something like that, you have to pay 50% but extend 50%. The point is, all industries are not affected similarly, and all units within an industry also may not be affected similarly. Those in containment zones are differently affected, those in outside zones are. So it becomes very case specific, isn't it?
Yeah, RBI provides the maximum, and within that, the banker is free to sort of to fine tune it in terms of whether 30 is required, 40 is required, or 60 is required.
So, you
are trying to give you a framework in bucketing sectors and trying to provide a maximum amount of relief which can be provided to a particular sector. But one other thing I want to flag, in this round of restructuring, the biggest problem was that any round of restructuring you do adds to the debt. What happened is last time around, the equity never sort of came at the right time.
Yes.
So here also, I think we need to have an eye on the equity position also, because as the debt increases, either through restructuring or whatever means, the equity needs to come, and otherwise this company is going to struggle even more.
Exactly, but you know, the debt check is already written and the equity is more a promise. I'll just come to you in a minute. Sunil Srivastava, first of all, I wanted to ask you, what should be the primary eligibility criterion, assuming of course that the Reserve Bank is going to give something on August 6th? Should it be only available for those who are not in default as of Feb 28? Is that a good starting point?
So, I've been listening to the other panelists as well, and the fact of the matter is any viability has to be established before you restructure. Now, these are exceptional circumstances, and the mistakes that we made in the past was that we assumed a future. Now, given the fact that we had a slowdown last year as well, and we have, you know, lockdown, etc., from March 1st is the cutoff date for RBI. I think March 1st is a very relevant date to look at not only standard accounts, but which were also SMA 0, 1 and 2, which were delinquent, but which had gone through the last phase of slowdown and survived. These are the companies. Now, these companies...
are you saying is that even if they are in SMA 2, the fact that they have survived the previous slowdown makes them eligible? SMA 0 should be the eligibility criteria. What you are saying is that even if they are 60 days overdue, you would rather give them, only they should not be 90 days. Is that your point?
My point is, let's get real. The slowdown has impacted the economy last year fully, and there have been...
This restructuring is not for that slowdown. Is for COVID, no?
So the point I'm making is, if we have an account as of 1st of March, as a standard asset, and a standard asset is SMA 0, 1 and 2 as well. It is not just standard. So as per RBI definition, it's delinquent up to 89 days.
Yes.
So these delinquencies, if they have survived on that day, number one. Number two, the size of the company or the size of the unit makes a difference. Three, the sector makes a difference. And four, the transactions make a difference. So now, instead of looking at the future, I think we should be starting to look at the past as to how they performed in the past. If they have been able to meet, have surpluses to service and amortize, they should be restructured to the extent of the installments which are being deferred over a period of 3 to 5 years.
Okay, you're a little more generous than I think the other two. Gentlemen, let me take a quick break, and then let me see if we can look at commonalities between all of you in terms of what should be the starting point as to who is eligible and what should the conditions of restructuring be. We are back in a jiffy. Welcome back. We were discussing if the Reserve Bank should allow banks to restructure loans of borrowers as a one-time measure, and if it does give that permission, what should the conditions be? My three guests, Sunil Srivastava, former Deputy Managing Director of SBI, V. Srinivasan, formerly of Axis Bank, and R.K. Bansal, formerly of IDBI Bank, are all agreeable that there is a case for restructuring loans as a one-time measure. Now we are trying to get them to tell us what the conditions should be. Mr. Bansal, you know, very quickly, what should be the eligibility? As of March 1st, should you be SMA 0 or SMA 2 and you should be eligible?
I would say that any account which was standardized on March 1, as Neelji also said, that should be eligible, because many times what happens, the cases keep on delaying, and then that time the view was that perhaps they will clear up to March, and in March they would have paid, but typically the business is quite good in March. So I would include the cases which were there as standard as on 1st March.
The technical point is that if it was a bond, they would have paid on day one. I can pay the banks even after 89 days is a behavior which Reserve Bank has tried very hard to stop, and of course it's not been very successful. But Srinivasan, what would your advice be? SMA zero. Okay, just for the benefit of those who find these abbreviations very inconvenient, SMA is simply refers to overdue loans. It is if it is 30 days overdue, then you call it SMA one. If it is 60 days overdue, you call it SMA two. And then, of course, if you're over 90 days, you become an NPA. Srinivas, yes, go ahead, Srini.
Yeah. What I would like to know is the discussion is downgrading versus restructuring. It need not be that an account, I mean, there can be separate rules when you downgrade the asset, and there can be rules in terms of when you restructure the asset. Now, it should not be one way. It can be a little more lenient in terms of saying when do you classify as an NPA, and give a little, as long as you provide for the asset and allow restructuring or whatever it is. So when I spoke to you first, in terms of how much relief you give for particular industries, I think as long as it is in a certain time band, it's fine. Otherwise, you restructure, you don't get the asset.
Can you be a little specific? What kind of a time band would you say that loans can be rescheduled, and a loan that has to be paid today can be paid over the, or loans that have to be paid up to today from March are extended to be paid within 1 year, within 2 years? What would the time limit be?
Anywhere between 2 to 3 years. I think first you got to get the business back on its legs fully. That will take a year or so. And after which the SOP is going to repay the whatever has been carried forward.
And you are saying that if they have been given that, you know, you are not paying your interest on time, to that extent banks should keep what, 15%, 10%? What should the provisioning be?
The provision should be the loss of NPV. I don't think so. I'm saying you should be as tight as possible in provisions, but a little more lenient in terms of classification.
Okay. Well, there was a suggestion that why not treat only those loans as Ind AS. Under Ind AS, you value it, you know, you give a fair value of the loan. Is that a good idea?
Banks are not fully ready, I think.
Only for the loans that they are rescheduling.
I know, given that, I think you will need a lot of data. I don't know how best banks will prepare for that right away.
Okay.
I think if you're going to implement it in the next month, I don't think so banks will be ready.
Okay. Sunil Srivastava, you know, while we're all saying that Srini said it very graphically when he said bankers themselves will not be willing because of the experience they had in weaning promoters away from the old corporate debt restructuring scheme. So they themselves won't be willing. There are a lot of people who worry that bankers will not give restructuring at all for fear that 10 years after you retire, some investigative agency will pull out your file and make life miserable for you. So actually they won't give at all. Do you suspect this could happen?
Yeah, you see, actually, if you look at it, the larger ones have actually deleveraged and sitting on cash without any investment. So most of the larger corporates will perhaps not require restructuring.
Yes.
And if they do, they will have to prove it on the basis of past data and not future projections, which have always been rosy. Mm. But my major worry is that out of 6.3 million MSMEs, almost 96-97% have loans below 1 crore. Mm. Now, while 25 lakhs and below have been allowed to be restructured up to December 31st, that doesn't take care of these 97%, and you don't have people in this bank, all the banks combined, to do a viability study for the number of units. So I think that's why I mentioned that it has to be on a size and sector basis. So on the size, the smaller ones, I think it should be a non-discretionary from the back end itself. Push the whatever is the installment which have been deferred into a funded interest or a WCTL, and then as you go up the scale, then you establish the viability into it, because you can't do this thing without establishing the viability.
Okay, so your classification will be on the basis of size.
Sector as well. So sector, there will be sectors like hospitality, aviation.
But you know, I that is the problem really. Mr. Bansal, can we have a sectoral distinction? Because you know, while you may say aviation is quite clearly broken and for no fault of theirs, and you know, 1 year down the line, the country needs airlines. We can't allow all of them to, you know, sink like Kingfisher and Jet. We want them to survive. So can it be sectoral? Because the problem then is, what about a company that is providing food only to the airline company? They will not come, but they are also dead. Or for that matter, someone who is only providing textiles to a hotel company, and hotels are by law under lockdown. Can you really do a sectoral restructuring?
I agree with you. To some extent, we can do that, as Neelji is saying, that airline or any industry, what you are saying, we can even define that industry related to that. Mm. But I had a slightly different point. Even if you give it, I think it should be given to in a general way. Mm. And today, if you try to restructure an air, deadline. We don't even know what will happen. See, we have been seeing a lot of complaints that CDR failed because we kept on, bankers kept on doing evergreening. But that's not the case. What it failed was that the assumptions on which we did a research and the economy, which was supposed to grow at some rate.
Mm.
Let me give an example. Out of the first 12 cases of RBI which went to IBC, CDR restructuring was there only in 5 days, five cases.
Yeah.
So what about the other 7 cases? They were standard, but still they had to be referred to IBC first.
Mm.
Because
so what are you saying? No. So therefore, you know, RBI has to perhaps come with a package on August 6th or very soon, because moratorium ends on 31st August. So if not on 6th, in the next 20 days, at least they have to come. What should they say the in terms of who is eligible?
So what I was
should
saying,
it be sectoral?
That is why we have to define it from that perspective, that any standard case, let us say as on 1st March, should be eligible.
Yeah, okay.
My only other request would be, like say we have seen this is happening in number of conditions which were RBI has come out with the June 7th.
You were speaking about assumptions of growth. Now what assumption of growth can you give when nobody knows how much the economy recovers?
So you can't restructure also as of now. Then we have to wait for that industry to get it restructured.
If I may come in, because you know, even the RBI, the government of India is not able to project when the economy will normalize. And how fast it will normalize, 20%, 40%, 60%. So most of these companies do not have working capital is always given only for 12 months. So in 2019, whatever was the working capital limit given, take that as a basis. And if they have met up to March, maybe 75% or more of the credit submissions and the figures there,
okay,
use that as a basis and extend it forward.
Srini, last word from you. That seems a very good basis. Maybe take a past normal year and go by that. There are also GST records available. See, I'm telling you, one of the suggestions I got from an expert is have an external committee, because banks will be wary of over investigation. Have an overseeing committee or a rating agency, one of the two. And the other thing was, can the government chip in with some database in terms of the GST payment of companies, so that you have a basis as to how much they can repay. Srini,
Lata, you are passing the tab onto the banks in all these cases. When an airline, I understand, is critical, but because you don't know what's going to happen, because the equity is not coming in, because you know that this is something which you have to live through.
Yes.
The entire tab is coming to the banks.
Absolutely.
You need to see whether equity or government, if such a critical sector of the government needs to chip in with some tier ones, yes, or mezzanine debt or something. So there has to be something which sort of provides some relief to the banks, otherwise the entire tax is coming to the banks.
I completely agree with you, and that is exactly what Urjit Patel is saying in his book. You know, saving the saver, it is not the job of the depositor to save a failing airline. It should be, perhaps if it's a national responsibility, well, then the nation also should pick up the tab. So for extreme industries, I take your point, Srini, say hospitality or airlines, more airlines than hospitality, probably something national should, something from the sovereign is called for. Maybe that explains why the finance minister also said that the government is in conversation with the Reserve Bank for restructuring. Perhaps something fuller will come in terms of the sovereign picking up something and the Reserve Bank offering something. We are all waiting for August 6th with a lot of interest. Suresh Vasudha, yes. Okay, actually, only 10 seconds. Yeah.
Yeah, one last thing is that I think I agree with Sunil that the focus we've been discussing is only on corporate sector. I think the bulk of the problems are going to come from SME and possibly retail. And I think those are sectors we need to find our way through, and the last cycle will not teach us any lessons.
Oh yes, retail for sure. MSME, I think the government has done a lot in terms of guaranteeing some part of the loans. Let us see how well that has worked. But we have to end this discussion. Thank you very much, Sunil Srivastava, V. Srinivasan and R.K. Bansal.